Hi, everyone. Welcome to part 8 of Textual Criticism of the New Testament. This will be the last installment of our Textual Criticism series. Hooray! We're going to close out with Alon's 12 Rules of Textual Criticism. So, you know, there's a debate, and maybe in a later video, if you guys want, we can talk about the majority text versus the critical view of textual criticism. But, you know, I think these 12 rules are very important to consider when approaching a text, even if you hold to the majority text view. You can't just ignore these rules of critical textual criticism. So let's take a look at what they are. Rule number one, only one reading can be original, however many variant readings there may be. And this is, of course, working on the understanding that the text was originally composed and it had an original reading and that variants arose from that. So there can only be one original reading. Only the reading which best satisfies the requirements of both external and internal criteria can be original. So rule two, of course, deals with the reading that best explains both the internal consistency of the text and the manuscript tradition can be considered the original. Rule three, criticism of the text must always begin from the evidence of the manuscript tradition and only afterward to a consideration of internal evidence. In other words, we can't say, well, I really want Paul to say this, because that's what the chapter seems to indicate. We have to start with the manuscript tradition, the external evidence, before we move inward. Rule four, internal criteria, the context of the passage, its style and vocabulary, the theological environment of the author, etc., can never be the sole basis for a critical decision, especially in opposition to the external evidence. So this is just a continuation or a nuance of rule three. You can't just have the passage dictate internally, especially if it goes against the external evidence. Rule five, the primary authority for a critical textual decision lies with the Greek manuscript tradition, with the versions and fathers serving no more than a supplementary and corroborative function, particularly in passages where their underlying Greek text cannot be reconstructed with absolute certainty. Greek has to be given primary authority. Even if you know that generally speaking, the father, church father, for example, is quoting something, and if you don't know that he's quoting from the Greek, you cannot reconstruct it, giving it the same authority as the Greek manuscript tradition. Rule six, furthermore, manuscripts should be weighted, not counted, and the peculiar traits of each manuscript should be duly considered. And this is important because there's a temptation when you do textual criticism to look down in that apparatus and say, well, I got four on this side and I got seven on that side. It must be the one that's on seven. You can't do that. They need to be weighted. The principle that the original reading may be found in a single manuscript or version when it stands alone or nearly alone is only a theoretical possibility. So rule seven is describing this idea that when you have something in a single manuscript or a version, you need to challenge that idea and say, why is it only here? Rule eight, the reconstruction of a stemma of readings for each variant, the genealogical principle, is an extremely important device because the reading which can most easily explain the derivation of the other forms is itself most likely the original. So again, you want to go, you want to reconstruct these genealogical families so that you can identify which reading most likely led to the others. Rule nine, variants must never be treated in isolation, but always considered in the context of the tradition. So you don't want to go to a particular variant and say, ah, this one makes more sense, and ignore all of the nuances that have come with that particular tradition. You have to consider it in context. Rule 10, there is truth in the maxim, the more difficult reading is the more probable reading. but this principle must not be taken too mechanically, with the most difficult reading adopted as original simply because of its degree of difficulty. So it's true, the more difficult reading is the more probable reading because the scribe is more likely to correct it to something that makes it easier to understand. However, you can't just say, well, this one makes absolutely the least amount of sense, therefore it's the correct reading. It's a principle, it's a guideline, but it's something that you need to weigh with the other evidence. Similarly, Rule 11, the maxim, the shorter reading is the more probable reading, is certainly right in many instances, but he goes on to say, just as with the previous rule, it cannot be applied mechanically. Finally, a constantly maintained familiarity with New Testament manuscripts themselves is the best training for textual criticism. And I want to camp on this for just a moment before we close and say that really understanding and reading and immersing oneself in the manuscript tradition, in the Greek or in the Hebrew with the Hebrew Bible, this is really the best training for textual criticism, because you begin to anticipate, you understand what it is that individual hands are doing. And in that sense, you can begin to anticipate, oh, this is a problem that I've seen before. This is common to this manuscript family or this tradition. And so it makes sense that I've seen this problem before. I've seen this error before. I've seen this variation before. And now I understand how it fits into this particular passage. In short, it's very difficult to come to textual criticism afresh. It's difficult to come to it without having really immersed oneself in all of the complexities that are these Greek and Hebrew manuscripts. So the best training is to read widely in these different textual traditions. Well, there we are, the end of textual criticism, both the Old and the New Testament. Of course, there's much more that could be said. And if there is a strong desire for people to hear more about specifics, we can definitely do that. I just thought this was a good closing point. And we're going to move on back to the ancient Near East in general, back to Mesopotamia. And we're going to be looking at A. Leo Oppenheim's book, who gives an introduction to ancient Mesopotamia. And I think it's going to be a lot of fun. It'll be very telling, or it'll be very enlightening. And I think it'll give us a good starting point to go into different discussions of Mesopotamian topics. So please stay with us.